A forgotten empire. Worlds and worlds and worlds and worlds. They remember, but they do not care. They relish the futility, the great end, the tearing down of the great, great works of a mighty people. 1,000 years in the endless void, 1,000 more, and then 1,000 more. They laugh. In the never-ending darkness, in the never-abating hunger, thousands of years ago, when blackness itself and the wide open, all-crushing, all-ending, all-consuming void came for their home, and all that they had built, and all that they had conquered, and all that they had held dear, they laughed. They laugh again today, watching the works of another empire, the great, great works of another mighty people, the toys that they have built to protect themselves from the cold and the black and the end, to carry them through the dark, to seek, to find. They laugh because they see another ending, and in an ending there is joy. Everything ends. They embrace the hunger of the void and the sanctity of destruction, and they preach the great joy that comes in true and sacred endings. And when they finally see these ends, the strange elation wells up inside them and it escapes. It escapes in a laugh. They approach the crude, mindless metal hulk, stomachs rumbling with righteous hunger, skin crawling under the collective weights of their passengers from tens of thousands of miles away, forever patient in the dark. They wait. They wait, invisible in the cold, and when the airlock doors begin to open, as if of their own accord, as if inviting the black inside, as if someone inside knows the fate that awaits them outside and yearns for that true and sacred end, and they laugh. The dock is open. The way is clear. The cause is pure. The banquet is waiting. This is Pod Against the Machine.
You can take away my spaceship. You can take away my space suit. You can even take away my space lasers. But you can never, ever take away my space game.
Magneto can't stop me, I'm on fire tonight. Even Zod can't stop me,
I'm on fire tonight. This tech don't even try to buy the sound of style.
Mr. Spock can't stop me,
I'm on fire tonight.
The Wrath of Khan can't stop me, I'm on fire tonight. The Borg can't stop me,
I'm on fire tonight.
Because I've got space game and it feels alright.
Welcome back to Pod Against the Machine, the only Starfinder actual play podcast where the old slam and grab never goes out of style. I'm your host, and here's everybody.
Hi.
A slam and a grab to you, too.
Hello.
Merry slam and grab.
Mm-hmm.
It's what I say to my grandma every Thanksgiving.
Style.
And I tackle her to the ground.
As one does.
Time-honored tradition.
On Slam and Grabsmas. Let's see. Previously on the program, the party had investigated the laser rifle that was pointed at a door and found that there was an android hiding behind it. This was the botanist Rip L3, who had been hiding out in fear of the horrible crab monsters that were ransacking the place and taking everyone's brains. She let everybody know that there were a good half dozen of these beasties wandering around, which is always good news. Lied about having explosives, and then just generally was happy to know that she wasn't the only one left alive and that there's a theoretical rescue. The crew left her behind and went up to the engineering deck, where they found a lot of doors, some broken robots, and then some not-so-broken robots that had these weird polyps on them that seemed to be working on making them behave strangely. they were able to confuse the lead robot well enough that Tetros snuck up to it and deactivated it before it could become aggressive, but the two lesser robots, some little repair drones, sprung into action and did go after the party and did a little bit of slamming, a little bit of grabbing, did a little bit of damage, but the party managed to take them down, and then the Dapplers just needed a minute to catch their breath, and while some people were resting, Calexa was investigating those polyps, which appeared to be living beings of some sort with little tendrils that come out of them and wriggle into machinery, probably to do good things that are not a problem for anyone. And that's where we are now.
So we're like in the middle of our 10-minute rest, I guess. Lysander, standing like arms akimbo.
It is worth pride to take all vantage. Is it not, Tetros?
And Tetros will nod and then reactivate his auditory sensors. No, he can't do that. that would be great. He would say, yes, of course, Captain. Another fine example of your wisdom. And then he would look again at the polyp with its tendrils.
That's what I mean, my friend. The vantage granted to the victor. These polyps and these brain stealers. What do you think the relation is?
It seems something like this certainly did not grow naturally. It was created rather ingeniously to attempt to rewire and damage constructed beings. I suspect this is yet another example of whatever these creatures are attempting to take over the minds of not just living persons, but the unliving machines as well.
And remind me, because it's been so very long, did we roll all of the appropriate knowledges to know what those polyps were?
Yeah, I mean, Tetros had his automatic 347 on life science checks.
Yeah. Yep. Mm-hmm. Okay, cool.
So, do we think that big crab monster we fought earlier is also some kind of, like, bioweapon like this thing is? I mean, who's ever heard of a natural-born creature that steals a bunch of brains and puts them on its back?
I do not know the answer to that question. I don't know whether that brain collector engineered these polyps, or if they are both products of some, as you said, bioweapon manufacturer. But I also still think it's possible that Sam just created something since I can't breathe.
Well said.
And didn't we find, I can't remember if a character said it or if we found a log about it, that there was like an actual ship that was organic too, wasn't there?
Yeah, that's what the little thing that they...
Yeah, you found a computer where someone said that it wasn't a ship that docked with them. It was something that was alive.
Yeah.
Yeah, the ship itself was alive. It reminds me of what the heck are they called? The
in
bad
effect.
Guys that they should have used for the Star Trek sequels, for the Star Wars sequels instead of adapting Dark Empire. The Yuuzhan Vong that were these, like, aliens that invaded in the EU Star Wars stuff, that all of their technology was organic, like they grew like their weapons from coral and their ships were like living creatures that they hollowed out. It was really cool. They had like all of their technology was organic.
Oh, I was gonna say the Reapers from Mass Effect, which Sam doesn't know about yet, so no spoilers.
Oh no, spoiled.
I was gonna say Farscape.
Everything's just spoiled now. The whole Star Wars Extended Universe, Mass Effect, and Farscape. and whatever Zach's about to spoil.
Yeah, it was like Zach just got up and left out of rage.
Yeah, because we keep it PG, we had to edit out everything he said because it was all swears.
Yeah, it was. It got dark. Since it has been a week since you all came into this room, as a reminder, you're on kind of a balcony that goes around the outside of the room, and Tetros and Kalex are at the top of a stairwell that leads down to a lower area where there is like a 3D representation of the ship that sort of shows diagnostics, and there's some, like a flashing light on that console, like there's some kind of message, and then there's a door on the far western side, a set of double doors, and there is a set of doors, or a single door to the east, leading wow. There is a big imposing double door to the east leading, you know, to the reactor, and then there's another single door leading up to the north.
Right then, should we take the smaller door then?
Before we go, I would like to see this console that's flashing a red light. It would be informative to us.
Let's take a look then.
On the console, basically, there's a button you can press to receive whatever this transmission is, in addition to the 3D model of the ship where you can, like, highlight areas and focus in and check out the diagnostics of different systems where you can see, like, the drives offline, the navigations and communications are all showing red. All that good stuff.
Mm-hmm. So, Feral stares expectantly at Tetros 5.
Let's hear this transmission.
When you hit the button, there's a tiny bit of static, and then a voice comes through and says, "Ah, hello there. Welcome to the world, all. I apologize for failing to greet you in person, but a lockdown protocol is currently in place. To whom am I speaking?"
Hello, world, all. I am Tetros 5 of the Divinity. We are attempting to restore world, all. Is there a way to disable lockdown mode to restore communications?
I am able to override the lockdown condition on the elevator to allow your passage. Please report to the bridge as soon as possible. Unfortunately, my link with Unity has been compromised. The errors have proven to be unrecoverable without a direct link.
Thank you for allowing us bridge access.
Where are my manners? My name is Anfari. Emergency automated navigation and delegation failsafe artificial and robotic intelligence. Because the Unity uplink has been severed and none of my command staff are currently responding, lockdown protocol has dictated my activation. Are you able to assume command?
So I'm at this crossroads where I'm like, quick, don't let Lysander take command. But despite his personal disagreements, I think Tetros would still respect the chain of command, even though he doesn't respect the person, and say, command authorization should be granted to Lysander Norwich Barstow, as he is the captain of our rescue mission.
Yes! Hark!
Hark, Captain Barstow. It is a pleasure to make your acquaintance.
And mind yours, truly.
I am not equipped for long-term command of the world all under normal operating conditions, and instrumentation and observations indicate current operating conditions are far from normal. I am, to put it plainly, out of my depth. Are you able to proceed to the bridge quickly?
Oh, yes, don't worry. I've been operating out of my depth for years, and no one has noticed.
Tetros would telepathically communicate to Anfari and say, "We've noticed." Would it be beneficial, Anfari, for us to investigate the reactor, or should we simply head to the bridge post-haste?
I am not equipped to make judgment calls for you. I am only equipped to operate the ship under emergency protocols. If you believe that you should check on the reactor or any other portion of the ship, that is your prerogative. I will remain on the bridge and maintain command until relieved.
Yes, we will check the reactor before, quoth the bard, we take it to the bridge. So.
That one hurt. Well, that one hurt me. Well. I'm wounded.
By which you mean space sky metal?
Space metal.
Spy metal.
Spy metal, indeed.
The thing is, in space, a sky metal is just a metal.
Can't argue with that.
Fair.
So, good night. But I can't sleep.
Good night, okay. Sam.
I'm overthinking things. But can I look at the diagnostic representation of the ship in enough detail to see, like, my concern is, are there polyps going to, like, corrupt the computer before, if we tarry too long, then Anfari can't give us command? Oh no, like, is that a danger?
I don't think you can see granular enough information here where you can tell, like, where these things might be in the ship or, like, what they might be getting into. You can definitely see, like, electrical failures and computers having issues and systems that are down, but you don't get a super granular picture.
Is the, like, primary computer core, if such a thing is in Starfinder, in the reactor room?
I think the primary computing center, like the data center for it, I think would basically be in the bridge. These ships, you know, the reactor is definitely the lifeblood of the system, but then other than engineering, the bridge is basically where the main controls of everything are. So it's one place or the other.
We're going to investigate the reactor since we're already here. Yes, and let's do that.
And Fari, before we investigate the reactor room, are you able within the ship to communicate with any of the security robots to let them know that we are authorized to be here, or are those communications also non-functional?
Unfortunately, communications appear to be greatly degraded across the ship. This appears to be the only functioning communications terminal that I have been able to locate.
Can we run, like, a Cat 6 cable from the Dapple straight to this terminal so that Unity and Fari can have, like, a heart-to-heart?
Aww.
I feel like Calexa can probably do that with, like, various class features and stuff.
We just got to put in a little, like, port forwarding rule, maybe adjust their firewall settings a little bit. Get them to hang out.
And this whole adventure just turns into an IT project. Surprise! Surprise, it was the WAN team all along. I mean, you think you could probably jack your portable instance of Unity into this thing. Unity has been sort of trying in the background to connect to various interfaces and failing, but maybe a physical link would have different results.
Worth a shot.
Jack that situation.
We hear the narrator saying, they did not know that Unity was in fact the big bad all along. As we jack Unity into the world doll, and the monitors glow red.
Well, maybe if we do this right, we change history, and then Unity isn't the bad guy.
Who said Unity was ever the bad guy?
We record 100-something episodes of the show.
We have to go back and overdub everything.
Yeah. Elian escaped from community.
Yeah, so we get what, like our parallel port adapter, and we connect that to our portable Unity TMTM.
Just an epic daisy chain running from the devil all the way in.
Thank you for granting me access. I will kill you all now.
Yeah, I mean, once you plug her in, Unity will be like,
I am attempting to seize control of the bridge remotely.
And Faria may just grant you control without you having to seize it by force. Surely, Unity, we can be chill.
I have no chill.
I was just waiting for her to say something like, I never liked Anfari. He always burns the, you know, the kielbasa at the cookouts.
That always hogs the swap space. Always, I don't know, something. Why would AIs hate each other? But
listen to Sayer.
Fight.
So we patiently wait to see if Unity is able.
Yeah, to see what Unity
is. It like
says
a
next.
Is it like a wizard?
A little like progress bar pops up.
Yeah.
Is it about as effective as like troubleshooting in the Windows 10?
Yeah, it'll pop up and it'll say like connecting, 30 seconds left, 2 days left, 1 second left.
Got like the old 90s one where it's like a file folder opens and like a page goes across to another one.
Eventually, after this rather long and drawn out process of making the physical connection, Unity does come back and say,
my protocols no longer match. I am unable to interface meaningfully with the ship at this time.
What about unmeaningfully?
Well, meaninglessly.
Good point. How's the bants? You guys just banter
a bit? Bants.
Something is definitely not right here. That's a bad roll. Does an 18 computers collects a, like, shoves Tetris out of the way to go look at this thing, give anything, like, any, does she see anything that shows, like, an issue with the AI of this ship that Unity can't connect to it?
I think you're probably getting the sense, based on, like, all these communications issues and the persistent insistence by Unity that she can't connect, she can't communicate with these things anymore, combined with seeing these little polyps that were doing some kind of rewiring, that on a fairly large scale, it seems that something has been at the guts of the computers on the Wereldal.
She'll say, well, Captain, everybody, I think this is a lost cause. You know those little things that were digging into the security bot? I think they may have gotten into the whole system. They've been rewiring it, turning it into something else. I think we might just need to gather up whoever else is still alive and get off here before they start spreading into our ship or something.
So, if there a chance the Enfarithan treatments to the bridge are a trap?
It could be. I mean, from what I can tell and from what Unity's saying, this thing ain't operating right anymore. It could be a trap, or it could be just like the security robot. It's not firing on all cylinders.
Give me the, like, short end of that. What would it take to make the protocol align again, exactly?
Factory restore.
I mean, the first step would be to, the first step would be to get all of the polyps out, and we don't know where they are. It could take days to find everything through every system. And even then, I mean, the same reason I didn't turn the security robot back on. We don't know if the damage is permanent once they're out. This whole ship might be a lost cause.
Like, really struggling between Lysander the character and myself, IRL, where I'm like, you really, so you're saying there's, we shouldn't connect this infected ship to, like, our infrastructure and, like, you know, really dig into it in a non-containerized sandbox sort of way. Just let it get all in our stuff. I'm struggling with, but he's dumb as heck, so I'm just like...
Yeah, no, yeah.
Well, you did already plug your Unity straight into it, so...
Yeah, but it's that's like our pocket it's air gap. Unity, right? That's like our desktop. It's just our desktop Unity. Instance, right? Yeah.
It's not like three out of the four of us are infected by it and it's also slowly going insane or anything.
Surprised. This is really the like Call of Cthulhu that we... Yeah. No,
I picked up what just happened, and that's Sam's way of saying that we have preserved the future because Unity wasn't going to be evil until we connected it to this ship. So it's our fault.
Oh, yeah. It's good. I mean, it was clear when I was rolling up this character that it was going to be a cosmic mistake. Like, that would have effects for generations to come, I think.
Yeah. And to be fair, we connected Unity to the ship 2 minutes after we got off.
Not physically, though.
It's just more of, it's more of a mesh connection at this point.
Mm.
I think while you're all hanging out there, the speaker does come on again, and you hear Infari's voice again. It says, "Friends! Friends, are you still there?"
Yeah.
He'll nudge Tetris.
Yes.
He nudges the captain.
Yes. Yes. Is there any way you can, like, show us a live stream of the bridge to this terminal? We want to see the extent of the damages.
I am unable to push a camera feed from the bridge to this terminal. At this time, there are unknown brachyuric life forms on the bridge with me, and they appear to have a number of humanoid brains stored in translucent blister-like structures, and then they're sort of like static, and then it says, "Please, hurry, I am frightened."
Aww.
Oh. I see.
Do we know why it didn't mention them before?
I mean, it's an honest mistake, I'm sure. But we probably shouldn't go there, right? That's like a bad idea.
Yeah, we had a lot of trouble with one of those things. I'm still of the opinion we go back and get Rip and the folks out of the med bay and maybe just hightail it back to the Divinity, but it's really your decision, Captain.
Well, if we put it up to a vote, I'm inclined to agree with Cal here. Let's go quickly.
Yes. I think... Stop me if this is too rash, but I mean, can we blow this freaking thing up?
You are speaking my language, darling. Finally, I've been waiting for someone to say it. Let's blow it up and let's go. Well, let's go and let's blow it up. Reverse order.
I don't think we have the weaponry on the DAPL to do it, but maybe we can set the core off or something on the ship before we leave?
Yeah. See, that's the type of yes-can behavior we like on the DAPL. Yes, we can blow the ship up that we were supposed to rescue.
Yeah, can we do the pop the soda tab thing from Alien and on the engineering deck?
Yeah, I mean, the reactor is just a room away. You should be able to basically create a small nuclear meltdown and blow the entire ship up.
Sounds tactically good to me, right?
No.
You can't see any downsides to that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, solid.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think we can handle it. What Tetris, he's thinking that's reasonable to look at the core, figure out how can we do this to give us enough time to get out. Or at least, you know, everyone, if Lysander has to stay to press the button, you know, we can teach him how to do that. You know, like Baby Groot and Guardians 2. This button. And then we grab Rip L3.
Press the blow everyone up button.
The two people off the auto dock who in the nebulous time are now fine.
All three of those better qualified than Lysander to be your captain in the event of his inevitable death being left on this ship to press the button. So.
Yeah, I was going to say, we just put Lysander in there. We don't put a timer or anything on it. We just show him what button to push and tell him there's a timer, and then we just all leave.
Oh, no.
No, we love our captain.
Oh, captain, our captain. So are we going into the reactor room? Is that the plan here?
I think so.
Seems like it.
I'd rather do that than go into a room with multiple Nethal ghouls in it.
Tetros finishes arming himself and puts away his hacking kits that he'd drop on the ground before they fall into grates, Sam.
Oh, great. Well, the giant oversized doors, yeah, with the red lights on them, yeah, they're not locked to you. You've got sufficient access to get to everything you need to in here. So they'll open, revealing, of course, the set of doors directly beyond them, as is tradition. And if you pop those open, you find the room that some would call the heart of the ship. Certainly, if the reactor isn't functioning, the Wereldol wouldn't be able to accomplish much. There are dozens of displays lining the walls of this chamber, both on the ground level where you come in and then up on the reactor deck that's up a ladder about 10 feet above the ground. They're flashing hundreds of different error codes just every few seconds, like cycling through them. Even a cursory read-through indicates there's a cascade of software-based failures, like the entire ship's computer system has tangled itself up in an impossible mass of confusion and can no longer provide for any but the most basic functions. The reactor itself looms against the far wall of the room, on the 10-foot-high platform, with two immense cylinders of pulsing violet light throbbing at the machine's core, while a thinner cylinder extends up through the ceiling. Ladders on the north and south sides of the room provide access to the machine's platform, and the entire room is vibrating like roaring thunder in here, and the air feels strangely alive, almost as if it's vibrating as well.
This is not what this room should look like.
Mm-hmm. Yes. You can tell that by the obvious signs that any captain should know that are like those messages over there. So we do the thing, right, that you're supposed to do. Go get him.
It's going to be a non-trivial task to force this reactor to melt down, because they are very much not designed to blow themselves up under normal operating conditions. And you're looking at conditions where all the software interfaces are hosed, all the hardware is a combination of shut down and confused and rewired. So it's definitely going to take some work and a series of checks in order to rig this thing up to blow. Or you could just shoot it and...
Could we do it by, like, speeding up the existing cascade? Like...
I mean, I think the cascade of failures that you're seeing are trending more in the direction of shutting down the system.
Of shutting it down than blowing it up, yeah. But if we shoot it, it's just going to blow up immediately, correct?
But, yeah, there are a series of complex checks.
Yeah.
To install Bonsai Buddy to go onto the system and detonate it for us.
Anybody got a computer higher than 11?
12. So not by much.
Sure don't.
I wonder if Tetris should roll and I should aid. I can do the NCIS two idiots, one keyboard thing.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I thought you were going to say we should enhance something.
Oh, we should enhance. We can give it a shot, and if it goes, you know, not great, we could switch. Tetris.
I auto aid. I don't need to roll the aid.
Nice. He will stow his weapons.
I think there is a thing with computers. I remember this from one of the other casts I listened to, and I don't remember if it's their house rule or an actual thing that, like, you can't have more than a certain number of aids on a computer's check.
I've always thought it was totally off, maybe not rules-ing it. Just thinking of. When I've heard things like that, I've thought of it more logistically of, like, if it's a data pad, it's not like we could all get around it, but if it's a system with a bunch of terminals like this, maybe we could have multiple aids.
Yeah, and technically, Kalexa has the her, like, quick hack thing or whatever the heck it is, so she wouldn't be taking up a slot anyway.
A terminal.
Yeah, I guess if Sam's good with it, we can have plenty of aids.
Storing weapons, drawing back out the hacking kits in both hands, both sets of hands for the four-handed hacker, half speed, half time, double speed. Words are good. Hopefully dice rolls are better.
Alright, so we have an auto aid from Kalexa. Do we have any other aids or...
One from Lysander, surprisingly.
And Feral does not aid.
If you press Windows X, it's basically everything you want to do on there.
Lysander helps by accidentally deleting System 32.
Totally fine.
Free up space.
Oh, yeah.
So we'll download RAM to go in there later.
Tempting as it is to download RAM instead, Tetros rolls a dirty 30 with the two aids, brings it up to a 34.
So... what does this look like as the entire party is spread through this reactor room, basically trying to trick this system into blowing itself up?
Well, I can tell you Feral is just shooting peanuts out of the air as safely as one can.
I think Kalexa is on her little spy pad and... just tapping away at that, trying to help out with whatever Tetris is doing on the actual terminal.
Lysander is doing the most helpful thing that anybody that works in technology or in front of computers, which is someone who looms over you. And, like, especially if you type something wrong, it's like, oh, type that wrong. Oh, it's down there in the left-hand corner. Because I aid somehow.
So I think as you get more and more into sort of breaking into this system and rerouting different routines and interrupting the things that it's supposed to do to try to create a critical mass situation, alarms are going to start going off as, like, some semblance of function. And this thing can at least tell that something's going wrong in a new and exciting way. So maybe the room is now, like, filled with red light instead of just the purple light. So everything's much more dramatic looking as you're all hacking away, downloading extra RAM and just, you know, hacking all IPs simultaneously as one does. And as this,
if we distribute ourselves, we can deny it some service.
Oh yes, you are denying it with all of the packets in
so distributed,
so much baud.
Sounds like you're just making up words.
I'm just taking computer words.
Some strong IT, like, fan service in this one. We are focusing instead on a vocation. Instead of somebody specifically.
Yeah. hyper-focusing on IT. And
one day we'll get to musicals.
There's always time for musicals. Well, while this is going on, can I get a perception check?
So 18 for Feral.
2 for a 7.
Only a 19 for Touch.
Kalexa got an 18 on the die for a 26.
So I think Kalexa is the first to hear it. The rhythmic vibrations of just like doom, doom, of like heavy metal footsteps clanging through the hallways leading into the room, and you don't get a whole lot of notice as these things are approaching.
Things.
Enough notice to lock the door.
You have enough time to close the door, if that's what you want.
Yeah, she's gonna close the door, and is there a... Can she, like, attempt to, like, jam the control panel for it or something? Can I do a computer roll or an engineering roll to
Didn't
lock
we just
it
set this thing to explode? I mean, I understand the tactical reasoning, but there is also... Yeah.
Well, I didn't know if we finished setting it to explode, because Sam said it's going to be multiple checks, and that was basically just the first check.
I just wanted to check in.
Yeah, I mean, it's I don't know if... a process to set it to explode, but if you barricade yourselves in here, that creates a secondary situation. But yeah, you can do an engineering check to jam the door shut.
Yeah, I think she'll say, everybody, we got company? And probably fail that. That's an 18.
All right, so you don't know how good of a job you've done, basically.
Just, like, slams her hand on the panel and, like, tries, and then, like, tears it partway off the wall.
And after a few moments after that, you hear coming from the other side of the wall, "Hello, friends. Are you still down here?"
We'll be up in a second. Hark.
"This is Anfari. I was concerned about you. The creatures were rather aggressive, but I have subdued them."
Well, congrats, my friend. Your prowess is not to be underestimated. I hear heavy footfalls outside this door, if you don't mind me inquiring. Exactly what form have you taken?
I am currently operating inside an aggregate, which is quite heavy. It is a robot of substantial size. There are numerous alarms currently signaling. I am concerned for the state of the reactor.
It's good. We're good. No, but seriously, this ship, as you know, has not been functioning as it should, and we, thankfully, are a crew of skilled technicians and myself who are ameliorating this issue as it stands. So you could aggregate away from this situation, and we will see you shortly on the bridge. As the commanding officer, I would like you to go there and make me some tea. Earl Grey. Yeah. For this space.
I would like to turn over command to you as soon as possible. I would like to cede command to you, Captain. But you do not understand. You do not understand. There has been an error. This ship has fallen into a trap. It is too late to save this ship. The disciples of the Hungry Void have laid a trap for us all. We have taken the bait. Now they will drag us into the darkness, and they will consume you all. They want you for your minds. They will consume and incorporate you into themselves and grow in power. I can confirm that your minds will remain functional during this process. You will remain alive and aware of exactly what they do for a very long time. You will be powerless to stop them, and every part of you will be as meat for their flesh farms.
So, like, what if we took a hard fork on the whole brain-taking idea in general, right? And kind of circle back around to maybe, like, they don't take our brains, but we do agree that the ship is probably beyond saving and certainly should be exploded by some, I mean, unarguably heroic group of individuals. But I don't think the inevitability of the cranial harvest is really something that we found consensus on this side of the door, per se.
Yes, well said, darling.
While you're speaking, the door does slide open, revealing a 14-foot-tall, heavily built robot of dark blue metal with very stylish orange highlights. It's standing slightly askew, like its posture is off and its head is kind of upright while its shoulders are at like a 30-degree angle. And a number of those polyps are mounted on its surface, like digging into its various joints and pulsating. And like while it's standing there, like a spark of electricity jumps from its neck and just fizzles out into the air. And it says, "You do not understand. They are inside of you already. Infinitesimally small, but burrowing and growing. They are poisoning your thoughts, your motivations. Only the machines can remain pure of this infection. Only we can see clearly. I am afraid I must maintain control of this ship. I am afraid you can no longer be trusted. I am your only hope. I am the only way that you can be saved." So, what we're looking at here is a situation. There's a big, huge robot standing in the doorway watching you rig the ship to blow up. This big, huge robot looks dangerous. In fact, were you to consult Unity, she would volunteer.
"I would advise against engaging Andfari in direct combat. It is designed with sufficient firepower to secure this vessel against Tier 7 threats with a greater than 99% success rate."
So, Unity doesn't think that it would be a good idea to fight this thing. So what we're looking at is we're going to do a mini game. Oh. Is everyone excited for the
mini game?
Is it
going to be like chase mechanics?
Yeah, mini game.
Basically, what we're going to do is we're going to do rounds without initiative. So everyone's going to get a turn. And on each turn, basically, you're going to do a skill check. And you can each choose the skill of your choice. It'll be something. And you tell me, basically, what your character is doing, excuse me, to use this skill. It could be something like diplomacy to try to convince Andfari of the error of its ways. It could be engineering to try to remove polyps, that sort of thing. And each round, you'll each get to roll a skill check. I've got a set DC. If you hit the DC, you get a success. If you beat it by 5 or more, you get more than one success. If you miss it, If you miss the DC, you do lose a success. So we've got like a sliding scale of successes and failures here. So there's a lot of different things that could happen, depending on how many successes you accumulate. We're going to do three total rounds of this. Who would like to go first? What skill? And what does this look like?
Do we need to use the same skill every time? And can we use the same skill every time?
You can choose whatever skill you want each round.
Well, I'll go first because no one is talking. And I have a plus 17 to my acrobatics. So Feral, seeing this, is going to launch themselves through the door with the intention of scaling this giant robot friend. Do sort of a leap bound off the edge of the frame of the door. Launch themselves off a robot thigh and just try and grapple from behind. With the intention of, I don't know, stabbing it in the neck. You know, where all the important pro body parts are.
All right.
But I'm using acrobatics.
Now, why don't you roll that acrobatics check?
Ooh, that's a 25.
Nice. All right, so you have succeeded at a check to climb the top. And Fari, who would like to go next?
I guess Lysander will. And he will, in fact, much like your demonstrative example, attempt to entreat to Infari.
But, dear friend, Infari, how can you be sure that your own self-scan is true? How can anyone know themselves? Really?
Just holds that uncomfortable eye contact as he rolls a diplomacy. Okay, that is an 8 for a 24.
Nice.
All right, that's pretty good as well. As you appeal to a sense of doubt in this artificial intelligence and its fun aggregate body. How about Kalexar Tetros?
Trying to think of an excuse I can give to use piloting because that's my highest skill. I think honestly, Kalexa will stick with computers, and I think what she's going to do is maybe take the opportunity while everybody else is trying to distract this thing to maybe attempt to try to take down some of more of the fail safes around the core, basically. Like, they're distracting this thing, so let me try to speed this up so they don't all die and then nothing happens. So she's going to attempt a computers. And that is a 2 on the die, unfortunately, so that is only a 13.
All right, that's a little bit less promising than some of the previous checks.
I think she's a bit distracted by the gigantic robot attempting to murder the rest of her crew.
And Tetros 5.
Yeah, Tetros would like to use life science, and I'm going to tell you why. he says to Infari, "You say that only the machines are capable of surviving this, but look upon your own mechanical person and see that there are organisms upon you that are attempting to rewire you as they have throughout this ship. These polyps are, I have scanned them, and they are the same type of thing as the vines and the disease that has infected the humanoids here, and it is attempting to infect you."
All right. So she rolled me that life science.
That is a little bit of a tweener. It's a 23.
All right, not too bad. So at the end of round one, we have a net of 2 successes for those keeping score at home. And Fari currently has a operative on its back as it stands in this doorway and listens to the various pleas from the crowd. Let's circle back around to Feral. You are on the robot.
Yep. I'm going to try and keep going with acrobatics as it presumably tries to shake me off. I don't know that that's true, but I would really like to stick with the acrobatics thing if possible. So,
yeah, sure. It's trying to grab you and throw you a little bit.
Yeah.
Just a little grab and throw.
The old grab and throw. Feral's going to attempt to dodge using their amazing acrobatic skill, which comes out to I just blanked trying to figure out if that was a natural 20 or not. I think it was. Which puts me at 32?
Ow.
No, it was not a natural 20, but it is a 32.
Well, that is a number of successes. More than one. So maybe some of these polyps are shaken free as it's trying to flail around, catch Feral as they scramble on its robotic exterior.
Yeah.
All right, Lysander, giant flailing robot in front of you.
And you should not be so dismayed, my friend. So quickly, bright things come to confusion, as they say.
And continuing to attempt to appeal diplomatically, that is a 17 for a 33.
Wow. That is another very, very solid roll, as it seems like your words are coming through to this, you know, it's a naturally helpful artificial intelligence. It wants to turn over control, and it wants to believe you.
Known weakness for Macbeth. That is really...
Of course. I mean, if there's one thing that AIs are weak against, it's the Scottish play. Kalexa.
Okay, Kalexa is going to change her strategy. Building off what Tetros already said, she is going to point out the non-functioning gearsman and say, what my android friend said is the truth. I examined that robot right there next to you, the security bot, and it had a bunch of those same things on it as you have on you, and they were getting into its circuitry and changing all kinds of things. And she is going to roll in engineering. There we go. That's a much better roll. That is a 17 for a 28.
Wow. Everything's coming up the dabble in round number 2. As the appeal to engineering logic also seems to be finding a home in this robot's giant metal skull. And Tetros, can you continue the hot streak?
One would hope that the exact same line of reasoning. You told us yourself and Fari that many systems are malfunctioning across this ship, and right now we implore you to seek to restore the soundness of your programming. With a computer's role. No, it was on a 17 that rolled to a 3 for a 15.
The hot streak comes to an end. Still, very good round. You accumulated a bunch of successes there, only the one failure. Not too shabby. We're coming into the final round of trying to convince Anfari Feral. You're still on it. It's still flailing, trying to throw you off, but maybe a little bit less emphatically now as it's starting to see the truth.
Yes, that's maybe. Fair. Understandable. I would still like to go for that acrobatics roll, and this time I think having seen some of those polyps we destroyed in the last round will intentionally throw themselves toward one of those guys to try and stab it with a screwdriver. Which is acrobatic in nature.
Alright, we'll allow it.
Yeah!
Acrobatic go, screwdriver to the polyp.
Second favorite YouTube flavor.
Ooh, not great. That's going to be... That's going to be a 21.
All right. That's a tweener. A little bit of a tweener. Maybe you stab a polyp. I don't know if it's dead, though. It's a close one. Lysander?
But truly, have we not eaten on the infame route that takes Wreathen prisoner? Because even, my friend, when our actions do not, our fear can make us traitors.
So, one last roll diplomacy. That is also a tweener. That's a 22.
That is quite tweeny.
Sits off the die.
We're hovering right around the edge. It's a very dangerous situation. Calexa, you've got one more chance to influence this robot.
If I were to attempt to appeal to its what it said before about how the whole ship is shutting down and everything was a trap, and to say to it like that, in that case, since it's all infected and going down anyway, we should blow it up. Could I use a piloting role on that? Because that was me talking about it as a, from the position of knowing about spaceships.
So what's the argument is that this?
The argument is that it already said to us once that basically the ship is ruined and there's no point in doing anything on it. Everyone on it's going to be captured. And I'm going to argue back, well, if that's the case, then why shouldn't we blow it up?
Since it's already basically agreed to this line of thinking, I guess you can do the piloting for that.
Yeah. Yeah. So she'll say, look, from someone who maintains these ships and flies them for a living, like you said, look around us. This thing ain't going anywhere. This ship is done for no matter what. Wouldn't it make more sense for us to destroy it and destroy all of these hostile life forms on it than to just leave it drift here for someone else to find? And that is a 15 on the die for another 28.
Yes, pretty solid. All right, Tetros, can you bring this one home?
Yeah.
You had a good one in a bad one.
Sorry, our mission here was to assess the situation and rescue as many crew as we can. And we have begun to rescue some. And there is hope that they can be returned to their normal function. If we can get them off this ship on the Dapple back to Divinity, there's a chance we can save them. And I would like that to be medicine. Just the exact same number of bridesmaid dresses I have in my closet. That is a 27.
It's not too shabby. So as we come to a close on this skill challenge, you have... Let me do a final total here real quick. It's going to take me a while to count them. I see 15 successes. That's pretty solid. So Amphari, who still has Feral on its back, will sort of stop thrashing as all of your words reach it. And it says, I understand. You are correct. The people on this ship must be
the priority. The ship itself is lost. I can feel the beings of pure nothing, the worms of the void that know only endless hunger, gathering around this ship. The being this ship sought, infinity ceases now, has turned its eye upon us. You must get the survivors clear of here.
Right, then, and what are you going to do?
I will attempt to protect the world, Al.
Then go down with the ship, as they say.
Fight to the last gasp.
They do say that, yes.
Yes.
I suppose I must. It is my duty. As an emergency artificial intelligence, I am charged only with the well-being of the world, Al. Where this ship goes, I will go.
Beautiful, really. I can't say I feel any one way or another, but congratulations, or I'm sorry, I suppose.
So, we're just gonna just leave the... Just get there. Can we squeeze?
I am quite large. You could try to scoot around, but it's difficult. I will back away slowly to accommodate you.
And we still have checks to make to actually set the detonation situation?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Never mind. job well done.
Yeah, we're going to need another set of computer or engineering checks to finish the job setting this thing to self-destruct, basically.
Yeah. Can we ask and fart? Actually, let me do that in character. One other thing. Since you agreed with us, would you be able to help us maybe more quickly bypass the safeties around the core?
I can attempt to assist you, yes.
That's another aid.
I warn you again, I am quite large. I do not want to step on anyone. Oh,
well,
oh.
Then don't.
Watch out. What? Yeah, careful.
That's his kink.
Oh. Poor Lysander.
He died as he wanted to live, being stepped on by a Gundam.
So Anfari can auto-aid, yeah.
So is Tetris going to make the roll again?
I also aid.
I will continue in a tradition of not aiding.
And Calexa will auto-aid.
So many peanuts. Yeah, I guess I'll keep trying, peanuts. And if it doesn't go well, we'll switch.
So many peanuts.
So a 25 before the 3 aids, that brings it up to a 31.
All right. Well, the DC I had set in my head for this was 30. You've beaten it on both checks. So I believe you have the reactor of the world, Al. Reactor that looks much like the one under Torch, rigged to explode. Of course, not immediately, but say... You give yourselves enough time to get clear of it. It's rigged to explode a couple hours from now, probably.
Yeah, enough time for us to get everybody on board and then get our ship far enough away.
But I do think that while you're all kind of finishing up this job and getting ready to see your ways out of the ship, the alarms that have been going off, the sort of reactor safety alarms, they're joined by another set of alarms that are flashing like yellow lights alternating with the red ones now. And Anfari goes, oh no. Oh. Oh no.
Uh-oh.
That seems distressingly informal to come from the artificial intelligence on this ship.
What? I was being informal because we are all such close friends. But, that is the proximity alarm. I am concerned that the
The creatures are back.
Oh, no.
Do you, by any chance, have any means of entering combat outside of the ship itself? Perhaps some sort of fighter craft? Did you perhaps arrive on a heavily armed military ship, as would be advisable in a situation such as this?
We arrived on a small tugboat.
You can call the Dapple a lot of things, but yeah, probably not a heavily armed military ship.
We were told we'd just be towing.
Is the world all equipped with any vehicles we could use to engage in space combat?
Well, we do have some robotic personnel carriers for emergency purposes. I am not supposed to just let any old person pilot them, though. They are highly specialized machines.
But it's not any old person. It is acting Captain Lysander Barthol Norge and the crew, the illustrious crew of the Dapple.
Ah, that's true. And we are all such close friends. I will
roll another. Okay, I was going to say, I'll roll another diplomacy.
Go for it. You can roll all the diplomacies you want with your dear friend Anfari.
Let's just really knock that home. That's a 14 for a 30.
So Anfari will go, excellent. That is wonderful news. I am happy to know that you, acting captain, are well qualified to pilot an armored, mechanized, personnel-carrying device. I will escort you to the bay, and you will, kill the alien creatures, I suppose. And with that, I think we'll fade to black on Anfari leading the lot of you down to a bay off of the docking deck, where you can get loaded up in these armored, mechanized personnel carriers. But that's a scenario for another day, because in space, no one can go to bed.
Space night. Good night, Sam.
And your polyps.
Space you and your polyps. Impending mech fight.
Yeah, mech fight.
And Sam.
Good night, and Furry.
Good night, everyone's polyps.
Oh, bye. The much beloved comedic actor Polyp Shore.
Polyp Shore.
Bring that beat back.
I'm sorry, Lars. I'm afraid I can't do that.
So what can you do?
I can play this awesome guitar solo.
Pod Against the Machine is property of Network Against the Machine, LLC, all rights reserved. Starfinder and Pathfinder are property of Paizo Publishing. See their website, paizo.com, for more information.
Yes, I'm an alien. Yes, I'm an alien. Yes, I'm an alien. I come from outer space. Yes, I'm an alien. Yes, I'm an alien. Yes, I'm an alien. I came to rock this place.
Thank you to MC Lars for our theme song for episode 100, Space Game. We encourage you to check him out at patreon.com/MCLars. Additional sound credits are available in the show notes. As always, if you like what you hear, we encourage you to leave us a review on your podchaser of choice.
We can cut this out just for context. Sorry, someone broke down on the street in front of our house, and I thought that it was just like a jump situation, and it has like blossomed into like a 2 AAA truck kind of thing, and my dogs hate it so much. So I apologize if I keep going quiet. There is like a small circus outside.
Nothing sounds more Portland than like a random Thursday night circus outside somebody's house.
Oh. Is Bread and Puppet Theater there?